गुड इवनिंग चंदन, एम आई ऑडिबल? Fine, everything nice.
How's the response for yesterday?
No idea.
Chandan hasn't got back to you with the response still, huh?
No, I don't know exactly.
we went into lockdown again today, so we hardly had any work, so we came back early.
Why? What is repeat lockdown there?
I don't know.
My goodness. Maybe number is, going up.
So we've got a repeat. UP is in lockdown till Monday morning.
We can start by now.
Yes. So, good evening, Dr. Bodh Chaudhuri, Dr. Aditi, Dr. Reshmi, and all participants, PD team. Today's flow will be like this. I will be starting one of my presentations on marking, pre-op, preference, and axis marking. That will be followed by another discussions of some case studies by Dr. Saurabh Chaudhuri. That will be followed by Dr. Himanti Chaudhuri. She will be sharing her journey for the Toric IUL. Then we'll have a short question answer session. I don't know for how many minutes. If you are interested, we'll continue it more. If you are not interested or if you are not finding it is fruitful, then maybe we'll be going a little bit shorter time. Then definitely we'll be going for a group photograph. Chandan will request all of you to keep your the video on so that they can have the group photograph. And after that, probably I'll be going for a closing remark, and we'll be having a feedback session maybe for 2 to 3 minutes. I don't know the exact time. So this is the today's the flow of events. So with all good wishes from greetings from Kolkata, let me start my presentation. So that's basically on preoperative marking and something on intraoperative surgical pulse for Toric IUL implantation. I'll go in my own way because the technique is such a thing. Yes, am I not audible? Chandan?
Yes, sir, you're audible. So
okay, fine. Some noise was coming. So the technique is such a thing, is always modifiable, while it goes in terms of patient benefit and the own comfort. So let me start with a very case. From the sheet you can see had a 624 right eye vision, 636 left eye. Left eye had an excision of pterygium 3-4 years back with cataract, and the right eye had an pterygium with some amount of cataract. So it is being advised for left cataract surgery, then the right pterygium, then right cataract, and the things has been advised for biometry, specular syringing, etc., etc. So in due course of time, while the biometry is being done, this is being there that something toricity has come, 41 and 44, the steep axis at 145 degree. Then the patient came to the surgeon for reviewing, for the opportunity for the Toric IUL. And the surgeon is also convinced, probably, will be going for the Toric IUL and asks for repeat keratometry and the topography. So in the repeat topography, in the surprise, it has come that the though there is a huge difference, something 5-6 diopter of cylinder, and steep axis, the axis is also moved something 135 degree. So when it goes to topography, it also shows a little bit atypical bow tie pattern with a little bit irregularities, is because of the pterygium. And if we analyze, this shows some 5.39 diopter of cylinder with a steep axis of 802. So while it, and this is same revealed to right eye topography also, and OCT was not that significant. That was the biometry one that shows again and 41 and 44 steep axis at 145 degree. So based on that, the surgeon decided that this is acceptable one. So with the toric calculator, the TH series is being selected with an intended placement of 105 with a residual astigmatism of very negligible one. But to an utter surprise, after the surgery, the patient came in complex power of plus 1.5 with minus 1.75 with 612, and the near vision is N8, and the patient is not that happy in the post-op refraction. So went on analyzing what went wrong. It's in repeat biometry. If you see so many people's improving to N6, near vision with some addition, with some distance, with minus 1, with plus 5 cylinder at 180 degree. Again, the keratometry shows a huge difference. The axis is, steep axis at 138 degree. And the patient, the repeat topography also shows a difference of same 5-6 degrees of this 5.64 diopter of cylinder, and the axis is at 138. Same applies to right eye. Now the patient is being offered that he can explant the IOL, can put in standard monofocal. He refused it. Patient explained about the surface modification. He refused it. Patient explained about the IOL rotation, the pros and cons, and he refused it. He said, "I don't want anything." But according to course, ultimately patient came, and I found in situations of this, somebody did a refraction of plus 3 cylinder at 150 degree, then he came for is there any solution. So I also explained everything, but the fortunate enough, he said he can go for a second surgery at best, that is a minor surgery. So I set on different calculations. So in my first post-op evaluation of the topography, though it is an irregular, you can see this is at 135 degree and the cylinder amount is 5.64. That is being repeated, that is again coming to 134 degree axis with a 6.26 of cylinder, both in the left eye on the different days by the different examiner. So I planned something to manage something like this, and with the toric astigmatic fluid calculator, I have found I can give some kind of relief. If I put an incision at the cornea, in the clear cornea at 135 degree, I can enhance, I can induce little bit astigmatism, and I will rotate this, I don't remember exactly in what degree it was, I will rotate basically on the 135 degree of axis, I'll place it. So on the toric calculator of astigmatic fix software, I have found that is giving a minimal amount of toricity. The modification I did, I induced a little bit more astigmatism by putting my incision at 135 degree and also giving an opposite clear corneal incision, and both incisions are little bit on the clear cornea and rotating the IOL at 135 degree. And according to my expectation, ultimately patient next day landed with an 6-9 or 6-12 unaided, and the patient is happy with an plus 2.75. Not that unhappy, it's not an usual outcome. I stored the video of that particular case for your analysis. So in my way, I am marking at 135 degree. Putting my incision at 135 degree, you can see the excised, pterygium over here, giving OBD, putting side port, and in the bags BSS, trying to separate this bioadhesion. First 180 degree from one side. It's a tricky game because it's an empty bag. I have to be careful. There should not be any zonular distress at the time of separating the IUL from the capsule. Sometimes I do use spatula, a flat spatula, and it's a very slow process. So the entire process was to free the IUL optics and the haptics from the capsular bag so that I can rotate. Yes, some extent I have been enabling and IUL started rotating. Now it is freely rotated. So now I am comfortable with a hook. I am rotating it to the desired axis, removing all the OBDs gradually. So this is somewhere 135 degree, this is a little bit snatched. This is opposite clear corneal incision, again at the 135, the same axis. So induce little bit more astigmatism and closing, making an hydration of the wound, checking the IOP. I'll come into my next video, what is the importance of it. And ultimately, the patient is happy. It's a forgiving surgery, believe me. This is the result. Next post-op day, the patient had 6-12 part with the pinhole, it is 6-9, and he accepted it gracefully. So I shared my experience, one of the complex cases. Probably Dr. Chaudhary will be sharing more interesting cases. So this is one of the part I do shared it. The reason is this. It's then forgiving surgery in the cataract group. Now, yesterday also Dr. Chaudhary shared you something. We need some information, patient information. This is the manual keratometry, diopter and axis. Those who are doing this is very easy, to put which one is the flat K, which one is the meridian. Then the steep K, then the steep meridian. Then the IUL spherical power. And definitely surgical induced astigmatism, it was an old photograph. Nowadays we put it something and if I'll come into it a little bit later on, then I put the button continue. And it auto calculates, it goes into a picture like this, it gives automatically what is the SN6T5 module. This is axis of placement is 54 degree. So these are the detailed calculation. Here it is being, when we didn't understood, the centroid value, 0.5, this is the residual astigmatism, 0.07 diopter of cylinder at 54 degree. So that is the planning and that comes into a picture like, I do suggest to keep it in your OT, check it. I keep it on my, view so that while doing the surgery so that I can see. And thank you, Alcon. This is a beautiful tool they have provided, to helping the technology to making it more easier. Now this is something interesting. This is something and term known as coined as centroid. I won't go detail into it. Understanding is two-dimensional mean of SIA for a series of patients. So what is two dimension? One is the magnitude, another is the axis. So that gives a centroid calculation can be carried out by using a free tool at www.siacalculator.com. Even if you don't calculate, if you rightly say it in case where I made the SIA value, this is 0.11 or 0.12, hardly matters, you know, that is in a single denominator. If you put, even if it becomes 0.15 cylinder, or even if it is becoming 0.08 cylinder, hardly it matters. For a default value, you can keep it 0.12 diameter of cylinder in case of surgically induced astigmatism if you use then 2.2 blade or 2.8 blade. Lots more of questions is coming about, you know, how do I go for the preoperative marking? In my experience, I tell you, make the patient seated positions, open the eye, keep it dry. Whether you are going for a slit lamp, I am not going in discussing in details, for the slit lamp marking or the freehand marking or the bubble marker, practically doesn't make any difference. The only difference is the matter of ease, who is doing it, how it is being done. What I do emphasize something on, you know, the in case of IOs, this is Toricam, a free available tool just to validate it. In case of your Android phone, this is known as iToric. I train my staff. So they do it. So you can see here the reference axis marking. This is at 180 degree. They do take a series of photographs. You can pick up which is really central. So this is an almost central. This is a little bit paracentral. This is a little bit paracentral. That comes at 179 degree. The mark is that comes at 179 degree. So it's very easy tool. Probably the Alcon people's knows. If you have any difficulty, you can call me. I'll be happy to share with you whatever the difficulties you are facing and to help you. For IOL implantation, this is basically a three step. One is gross alignment, removal of the OVD, and the final alignment. These are few pictures. So coming on to surgical pulse, one important part is OT staff and anesthetist must understand the process. Need to sit patient up to mark the horizontal axis before sedation or block, not in lying down, because we know the intorsion, the extorsion that can spoil your entire thing. And another point I'll highlight, the where you will mark, that should be dried. Be sure all staff knows that this is a toric patient on the list, to be sure that necessary procedures are followed. Means marking, marking, marking. Friends, I can tell you, introducing toric lenses is a necessity in routine surgical practice. Why necessity? Because that gives a good outcome to our patient. And believe me, that provides a safe and predictable alternative for cataract patient with coexisting astigmatism. Only a minor modifications to a surgeon's routine cataract technique are required for the success. Nothing else. You can practice it even with a monofocal, which is being extra required, is a reference marking and the axis marking. Rest things are being done online, putting the data, checking the data. Alcon made it so user-friendly. That is really good one. Now, yes, all the time the question may not come into our, acceptable to either to as a surgeon or to a patient. Then you have to know a little bit what are the process. You can go PRK versus LASIK or glass versus contact lens in the first patient. As I said, everything has some limitations, delimitations. So according to case, you have to take the advancement of the surgical tools. Yes, some questions are there. If there be any PCR, whether I can put a toric IUL. So this is a simple case. I just share with you. Oh, So Rexis is being done. It is almost central, adequate size. I use an MBR knife, 15 degree. It's my habit. Hydro dissection, hydro delineation at one goal, rotating the nucleus, a little bit sculpting. While making the trench, I found there is an PCT somehow I made. So I became slow. That's because of the centurion fluidics. How safe it is, you can see. I turn on my vitrector. That vitrectomy also had some advantages apart from your routine vitrector in terms of parameter. You can see this vacuum of 496, aspirations of this and irrigation of this, all are in the fixed module. Thank you, Madhu. You taught me regarding this advancement, and really now I am enjoying it. So whatever the anterior phase vitreous was there, I cleaned. But I learned from my basic knowledge, when I don't see, I don't proceed. So in this case, I decided I must see. So I used one hook, four hook. You can see the beautiful rim is coming up. There is the dehiscence. Five hooks. Then I can see here is a linear tear. I went the IUL in the capsular bag. Rotating the IUL in the desired axis. It was not a very small PCC. I confirmed its stability. In the bag, this IUL is. Started removing these hooks. And completed the IUL. You can see fairly stable enough. It's not rotating. So the question is this, if I encounter any PCR, is it advisable that I can go for enteric IUL? It depends on the case. The basic principle is, if there is an PCT, in this case it was a little bit larger, so I couldn't make it and turn up into an PCCC. With the vitrector I did it. But the size of the PCCC should be less than anterior CCCC. And if you find the IUL stable, it is vitreous free, you can put enteric IUL. This is one of the video. Again, I'll go on talking about surgical pulse. So after the axis marking, Rexis is being done. Multi-layer hydro delineation, you understand this is an PPC. It's a young patient. And you can see hardly any CDE. With these parameters, I am aspirating all the soft nuclei and the cortical matters. It's because of the centurion machine, the chamber is so stable. Doing the irrigation aspirations take little bit extra time to clean the residual, putting the IOL take some time. Yesterday also I said I have a bad habit not to use the OBD, but it is not very good practice. It's an advantage this Actisoft platform takes little bit time to unfold. In the meantime, you can put it into the desired axis. From behind the IOL, there were some fibers, I cleaned it. But the important part lies over here. I do practice when I go for, you can see the movement of the anterior chamber in the pupil. It's gradually coming up. So I started hydrating. Please, friend, keep in mind, it should not be overhydrated, the bag will be loose. It should not be underhydrated, the bag will be tight. So there is a chance of IOL rotation. So I check, recheck, main wound, side wound, everything, and check manually the intraocular pressure. So it is optimally pressurized, not overhydrated, not underhydrated. With these few words, I thank you all for your patient hearing. With this, if you have any query, you can ask me or we can go up to the next question and answer session. I should invite Dr. Saurabh Chaudhary for his case discussion. Thank you.